Hey everyone, Jason here. A couple of months ago, I posted a video of my Robot Dreams GBC module in action. And today we're going to take a closer look at how it works and discuss some of the design aspects of it. Probably the biggest design feature that wasn't really apparent in that video is that it is completely modular. On the front end, we have the power unit, which right now has an L motor and rechargeable battery box. But pretty much any motor and power source can be used. Obviously, in a show environment, I'll be running it off of a 9-volt regulator. We also have the intake unit, which is just a variation of a pretty standard GBC intake design. In the middle, there can theoretically be any number of robots and the transfer pedestal units between them. And at the end, we have an exit unit, which feeds the balls to the intake of the next GBC module in the line. Even though the number of robots is theoretically unlimited, practically, of course, there's a limit to how many a motor will be able to drive. As more robots are added, there is obviously more friction in the system and more work that needs to be done to pick up and move the balls. The robots themselves are just mounted on a turntable, so they can rotate from side to side, and their arms are attached to an axle running through the shoulders, so they can move up and down. This design allows for a single control rod mounted on that shoulder axle to be able to both rotate the robots and raise and lower the arms. By connecting this rod to the end of a crank, we can see that rotating the crank does double duty to do both of those. Essentially, the horizontal component of the crank's movement translates to the rotation of the robot, and the vertical component of that movement translates to moving the arms. And we can oscillate that crank back and forth by driving it from this reciprocating arm coming out of the power unit. And as you can see, that arm is segmented so that it can be extended to accommodate however many robots are in the system. A lot of people commented on the relatively new splack gears that I'm using to transfer power to the control crank. And there is a very specific reason I use these gears instead of normal Technic gears. That is because they have this cool property where if you have two of them meshed together, you can perfectly mirror the movement of two arms attached to those gears. This is actually impossible to do with any pair of modern Technic gears. One of those arms will always be offset by a little from being perfectly mirrored. You can also see that I've doubled them up. Since their teeth aren't primarily designed for mechanical performance, this just really locks them together so the gears don't slip. Now, let's take a look at how the robots actually pick up and release the balls. I really wanted to keep it as simple as possible, so I came up with this passive system using these soft rubber Technic connectors mounted on the ends of two axles. These axles are free to rotate, so the grips can open and close. And I'm using a rubber band to constantly pull them to the closed position. There is a Technic connector in the middle with a couple of half pins jutting out on either side, which keeps the closed position just a little bit smaller than the diameter of one of these balls, so that when the gripper is placed over a ball, the ball fits nicely inside and the elastic keeps enough tension to hold the ball. To release the ball, I just added a bar to one of the grip axles, so that as the entire robot moves to the left, that bar will hit a stanchion on the pedestal unit, which opens the grip and drops the ball into the pedestal. The pedestals are designed with a small piston inside. When the balls are released, the piston is in the down position, leaving a nice hole for the balls to drop into. When the balls are picked up, the piston comes up and pushes the balls into the gripper. Power for each of those pistons is drawn off this line axle in the back that runs the length of the model. And just like the reciprocating arm, each pedestal unit extends it to drive the next one. And when we put all of that together, this is what we get. I have received a few requests for instructions for this, and I might put some together at some point. I would actually like to test it running at a show first to see if it needs any design tweaks, so that might actually take a while. And that's about all I wanted to talk about in this video. As always, thanks for watching, keep on building, and I'll see you in the next one.